فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء للناس وما يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, tonight our topic is one of the most challenging diseases that we are facing in this country. That not only is a big challenge among adults, now you can see it's a challenge even among the youngsters as well. And to understand how dangerous this depression is, the researchers, some of them said, one in every five American is facing depression. One of every five people is facing this challenge. That is a lot. For that matter, I wanted us to discuss this topic, and I want to do it in two ways. One is to talk about what the researchers have said and what they gave as a solutions, and then come and say, what is the Islamic point of view and what are the Islamic solutions? So it's going to be two ways. One is the researchers, humans, and then one is from the Islamic point of view. Now, first I want to divide the topic in two sessions. One is that to talk about causes of depression. Two, the signs of depression. Meaning, what causes somebody to go into depression? And two, how can I know that I'm depressed or not? What are the signs that people have mentioned? And then we come to the Islamic point of view. Now, number one, the researchers, they said that one of the reasons, one of the causes of depression is abuse. That's number one. A lot of people who go into depression, when you go back to their life, they either been abused in one of the ways. Because there are two kinds of abuse. Number one, it's either physical or emotional. People who have been into this struggle, who have been abused either physically or emotional, they're mostly likely to end up in depression. That is number one. Number two, people also who go into losing somebody who is so dear to them, either a loved one, a father, a mother, a wife, a husband, somebody who is so dear to them, when they lose them, it can also cause depression in their life. Because some people, they cannot let it go. They know the person is gone, but they cannot at least let themselves to understand. They cannot convince themselves that it's time to move on. So that can cause also depression. That is number two. Number three, divorce also can cause depression too. And all these, that's why when you go, Islam forbid all these things. Because those things, we see them as something that is light, but when you go deeper, they have more effect. They say number three, one of the cause of depression is divorce. When people go into a very bad divorce, it can lead one of them into the state of depression. So that is cause number three. Number four. Some people can go into depression because of certain medication they take. And that is why we have to be careful about medications. Because most of the medicine that we take, they always have side effect. All of them. So one of the side effects of some of the medication can also lead someone to develop depression. That is number three, number four. Number five, they said depression can also cause by genetic. Yes. If a person is born from the family who also have a history of depression, they can transfer to from one person to another. Because you know, in Islam also agrees with this. There are certain things which can be transferred, certain qualities, certain things can be transferred from one person to another. Example, bravery. It's a good quality. It can be transferred from one person to another. Now, how do you know that? From Imam Ali alayhi salam. Allahumma salli alayhi. You know, after Zahra alayhi salam's shahada, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Imam Ali alayhi salam, he wanted to marry, to get married. Then he told his brother Aqil, he said, Ya Aqil, ibhath li imra'atan. Find me a woman who has been born, who is born by waladatha al-fuhul al-arab, by the brave men of Arab. Now, why is he looking for somebody who has been born by the father is a brave? Because she can get the gene of bravery from her father. And that will help her also to transfer to her son as well. So Imam Ali alayhi salam was making it for sure, telling his brother Aqil, he said, when you choose me a woman, make sure that her father is one of the brave of Arabs. So she can have the gene of brave people. So, one of the things that can happen to a people who are going into the state of depression is if they have a family history of depression. And you can go even today, they have also proven that not only depression, there are certain things also people can inherit from the blood-related families. Example, high blood pressure. It can be also inherited by genetic too as well. So there are certain things we can inherit. One of them, they say, is also if the person, the family have the history of depression. That is another one. Another one, they said, people can also go into the state of depression if a major event happened in their life. Something big happened in their life. Example, losing a job. And you can see, mashallah, it happened a lot in America. Somebody lose their job, they lose their mind too. So what happened? They take a gun, they go to the mall, they start shooting innocent people. Yes. A major event in their life, they lose something that can lead them to depression as well. Right? And there are so many and so many. But these are some of the few things they said it can cause depression. Now, what are the signs of depression? Number one, they say if a person is having a difficulty of sleep at night. But if you have a good excuse, that's different. Huh? Let's say I slept all day. Okay, it's going to be difficult to sleep at night. That's not what we're talking about. Somebody at night didn't sleep, is tired, but can't go to sleep. Will be turning left and right, can't get to sleep. That can be one of the signs. If it happens over and over, that can be some signs about depression. That's number one. Number two. They said that having continuously nightmares. Continuously having nightmare for 6 months, 3 months, every time one goes to bed, they have nightmares. They say that can be a sign of depression as well. That is number two. Number three, feeling tired all the time without any good reason. You haven't done anything, but you feel you're tired. There's no reason to track and say, no, I have done this and this to cause me to be tired, but I'm tired. That can be a sign of what? A sign of depression. That is number three. Number four, not feeling, not having energy to do things you normally do. Things you normally do, often, and it's normal in your life, when the time comes that you can't do them, you feel lazy of doing them all the time, often, then it's also a sign of depression. Another one, they said, one of the signs of depression also is, if one started to feel like life is not worthy to live anymore. Started thinking that way. Like life is not important anymore. Why am I living? What is the purpose of this life? When a person started to enter to feel this way all the time, they say that is also another sign of depression. Another sign. If one cannot concentrate on small things that they normally concentrate on. But this doesn't apply to namaz. You know, we don't concentrate that anyway. Namaz, forget it. No, we're not talking about namaz. Because, you know, most of us, mashallah, when we say Allahu Akbar, that's where the brainstorming starts. Right? So namaz doesn't count. We're talking about a little things that you can concentrate. Example, I leave my keys here. I can't remember where I leave my keys. No, I go up and down, left and right. I can't. Oh, now I left it here. Simple things that a person can remember easily. If it becomes an issue to remember, that is a sign of depression. That is another one. Another one, they said, if a person started to gain a lot of weight for no reason, a lot of eating disorder, that can be also a sign of a depression. Because, you know, mashallah, some people, when they're depressed, the only way to express it is through eating. They can't stop eating. Right? They keep snacking. That is one of the sign of depression. Or the opposite, if somebody started to lose weight, because it differs on people. Some people, they gain weight, and a sign of the depression. Some people, they lose weight, and that is the sign of depression. Which is, for the losing weight, if a person started to lose weight, and without any reason, that they are not exercising, they are not also on diet, but they see that they're losing weight, that could be also another sign of depression. Right, that is some of the examples that our researchers have given. And so on and so on. So these, as you combine them, they think these are the causes of the depression, and two, these are also the signs of depression. Now, let's come to Islam and Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. In Islam, what does Islam say about the cause of depression? And this hadith is mentioned by our 10th Imam. When a man came to him and he said to him, I am depressed all the time. Can't stop it. So I need your help, Imam. Imam alayhi salam told him, first, I have to diagnose to you the cause of this depression. And then two, I tell you the medication, what to do to solve this problem. Then Imam told him, this is the first cause, an Islamic point of view, the first cause of what we call depression. According to Imam, he says the first and the cause of it is lack of qana'ah. Qana'ah is lack of contentment. Contentment. Meaning, a person, whatever they have, they are not content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them. Imam said that is one of the cause of it. Amazing. And when you go to our life today, you can see this is one of the signs too. That there are certain people, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them, they are lacking a contentment into their life. They cannot be happy with whatever they have. Whatever they have, they're still not happy with it. That is number one. Number two. So number one, according to Imam, it says lack of contentment in your life. That is one. Number two, Imam also said, Hubbu dunya, yes, is one of the causes. Love of this world. When it becomes part of somebody's life, then the world becomes their soul. In one of the dua of Imam Zain al-Abidin, salamullah alayhi, salamah. He says, Allahumma la taj'al ad-dunya akbar hammina. Ya Allah, don't let this world to be the greatest sorrow of our lives. People who are, they have hubb ad-dunya, the love of this world, they always have this attachment to this world. So what happened? When they lose something, it becomes a major issue. When they look at something to have and it didn't happen, it becomes a source of depression. That is one of the reasons of depression that Imam said. That is number two. Number three, they said, one of the causes of depression is some major sins. You know, every sin that we commit, they have their own effect in our lives. And one of the effects of some of the sins is to lead a person to a depression. And what are the causes of those sins? One example I give you, which can lead to depression. Killing innocent life. An innocent life doesn't matter. Don't think about human being. I'll never kill somebody. Killing animals which does not deserve to be killed can lead to depression. Now, somebody can ask, what is the, how can we prove this? Number one, you know, our scholars, they made the reference from the Quran. Like when Qabil killed his brother Habil. Look at the Quran. What did the Quran says? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, after he killed his brother, he said, فَأَصْبَحَ مِنَ النَّادِمِينَ. And nadama, regret. And they said, that regret, it can lead to a depression. Killing innocent life, whether it's a human being or animal, any life that matters, I killed them for no reason, it can lead to a depression as well. That is number three. Number four, they said, one of the causes of depression also, our scholars, they said, lack of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Forgetting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person completely forgets Allah, one of the things that happens to them in their life is to lead them to depression. These are some of the keys that our scholars, they mentioned about the cause of depression. Now let's come to the solutions from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam and the Quranic point of view. How can one take care of this depression and try to get over of depression? Number one, dua is one of the best solutions of depression. Allah, brothers, trust me. Have you ever seen any person who reads dua constantly become depressed? You search and see. If you ever find somebody who every day, at least they have 10, 15 minutes, they sit down to read dua and they still have depression, that is impossible. You can never find a person like that. Because dua helps you to overcome the sorrows of life. Now, which dua is the best dua for depression? The first dua and the most important dua is Hadith al-Kisa. Hadith al-Kisa is the best remedy for depression. Now, I'll give an example. Because in Hadith al-Kisa, there is one part we needed. If we are to think about it, you will think that Imam has given us the solution to this disease. Number one, in Hadith of Kisa, you know, there is a part we read.
وَلَا مَهْمُومٌ إِلَّا وَفَرَّجَ اللَّهُ هَمَّا.
Mahmoom means what? A person who is depressed. In Dua al-Faraj, in Hadith al-Kisa, we say, وَلَا مَهْمُومٌ. No person who happened to be in depression, إِلَّا وَفَرَّجَ اللَّهُ هَمَّا. If he reads the Hadith al-Kisa, or in the gathering where Hadith al-Kisa is being read, Imam said the person will not leave in that gathering unless his depression is taken care of. That is number one. So if a person, one of the medication of depression is Hadith al-Kisa, if one can read it, and you can try this, brothers, and this Mujarrab also from some of the scholars, if a person is experiencing depression, read Hadith al-Kisa for 40 days, constantly, especially after Fajr prayer, or before going to bed. They say definitely the person will overcome that depression. 40 days, either after the Fajr or after before going to bed. They say definitely the person will not experience that kind of depression anymore. That is number one. Number two, one of the things that our scholars mentioned about one of the best way to overcome depression is Al-Quran. Al-Quran, amazing. Wallah, Quran is the best medication. You know, let me just give an example and then come back to the point. You know, when you go and you buy any item in any store that you can go today, let's say computer or camera or any other item, they come with the manual. And the manual tells you how to operate them, right? How to operate, how they function. If you and I said, I don't want the manual, I want to generate my manual, I want to use it in the way I think, what do you think is going to happen? Disaster. Because you didn't make it, you didn't know about it, you have to follow the maker of that item in order to get it to function properly, right? Now take it this way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the maker of human being. Right? He created us. And when He created us, He said, look, this is your manual if you want to function properly. Right? And the manual is what? It's the Quran. If you want to live a life and function properly, away from depression, away from any difficulty, Quran is the solution. But we came here and said, Ya Allah, yes, you made us. This is the manual, but we don't want the manual. We want our own manual. That is where our problem comes in. If we said we will go back and take the manual of Allah, which is the Quran, our life will be perfect like the example of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. That is one thing to remember. That is number one. Number two. Now listen to what the Quran said too. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. He said, with the remembrance of Allah, the heart finds peace. Now we want to find peace in music, right? Somebody said, much of music makes me calm. Some of us, we want to find a music, what do you call, peace in what? In dancing. Some of us, we want to find peace in other things. Now the Quran, Allah who created us, He said, the peace can only be found where? In His remembrance. So if we start to be closer to the Quran as much as we can, read Quran as much as we can, that can also eliminate what we call depression. That is number two. Number three, as we mentioned also, is dhikrullah. Any remembrance of Allah, dhikrullah. Any dhikr, any word, any name of Allah. You take Ya Allah, Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim, any Allah's name that you can make it as. You know, mashallah, today when you go to the doctors, they have different medicine for what they call it, anti-depression. Right? Some of them you take them one day. Now, spiritual medicine, you take Ya Allah. Every day call Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah 100 times. and see what that will help you to overcome your depression. That is one of the medicine. Our scholars, they mentioned, they say, dhikrullah, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, Ya Ghafoor, Ya Rahim, any of Allah's name can be a medication for your depression. That is solution number three. Now then, our scholars, they mentioned other things too, which is more physical. One of the things they mentioned about helping to overcome depression, they say to exercise. It helps a lot. And you will be astonished that you see our imams, like Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi, Allahumma salli alayhi. He emphasized about exercise. Even in Dua Kumail. When you read Dua Kumail, pay attention careful. Imam Ali alayhi salam, one of the things he emphasized is about to how to exercise. He says, Allahumma qawwi ala khidmatika jawarihi. Ya Allah, strength every part of my body so I become stronger in your service. In the sharah of Dua Kumail, they mentioned that here Imam is emphasizing what? About the importance of exercising. Not only that, you go to Quran too, in tafsir, you know, in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about people who cannot get married because of one reason or another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَلْيَسْتَعْفِفْ الْأَفَّ, they said, and most of the hadith, they asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, a person who cannot get married, right, because of any other reason, what do you suggest for them so they can at least control themselves until the right time comes? The Prophet said, I suggest them to exercise. The Prophet tells us more than 1,000 years ago about the importance of exercising. Now our scholars, they say one of them also is about how to exercise. That is solution number two. Number two. They said also, one of the ways to get out of depression is not to be alone. If a person is experiencing depression, it's highly encouraged not to be alone. Meaning, always he should be with other people. Because the more you sit alone, the more you start to think, and the more it leads you to continue in that depression. But as soon as you started to socialize with people, then it helps you to overcome that kind of depression. That is number two. Number three, which is also Islamic, but it's also, it's one of the examples that I saw some of the researchers also have mentioned, is to always have, if you don't have something to give to keep yourself busy, is to be in voluntary work. Find yourself something that you can volunteer to do. Either go to the library or at least come to the masjid. MashaAllah, we need a lot of cleaning and putting the carpet together. Come to the masjid, work in the masjid to help do something that will keep you busy. Because the busy you become, the less you become into the state of depression. And some scholars also mention that one of the things that they helps, they say, going to the sea. Allahu Akbar. Now when I saw this, I could relate how the prophets loved to go to the sea. You know, one of the prophets they mentioned, he loved to go to the sea always, every morning, is Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam. One of them also is Prophet Ibrahim. They say after their morning prayer, they always go to the beach and sit there just to look at the beautiful creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, some scholars they mentioned, they say one of the solutions of depression is just to look at the water. When you look at the water, they say that can give yourself also some kind of comfort, and it helps to eliminate that kind of depression as well. So these are some of the solutions from our scholars. But the best remedy, as we mentioned, is dua, brothers. The more we keep that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the less we become depressed, inshallah. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala muhammadin wa ali muhammad. Allah. 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 Allah
question and answer session, sisters can go ahead first. Go ahead.
Yes.
I often read that, and this is what I'm talking about, but I often read that the punishment for suicide is perishing in hell forever, or some words to that effect. Now, I'm wondering, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He will not give you more than you can handle, time and time again, what is there to be said for the people who take their own lives? And is that hadith, quote unquote, I haven't checked the authenticity of it, but is it accurate? And what is the reasoning behind that, if it is?
Yes. The question is about what is the punishment of those who take their own life, which depression sometimes it leads to that. You know, people when they get to that point, you know, as high as it goes, somebody, people that can get to that level of taking their lives. So what is the punishment of a person who takes their lives? Yes, we have a hadith that taking someone's to take their own life, the punishment is hellfire, yes. In Islam, it's absolutely haram to take your own life. Why? Because there's a reason. If somebody comes and gives you $1,000, they say, this is my amanah to you. Right? Keep it to me until I come and take it. Right? Do you take the $1,000, go to Walmart and start shopping? Of course not, because it's not yours, right? So you keep it until they come and they say, okay, I want my money back. You give them money back. This life that we have is amanah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah trusted you and I and gave us this life. That is why, listen to the Quran. When Allah created Adam, what did He say? He said, فَإِذَا نَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي. When I blow in him, my spirit, not yours. So the ruh that we breathe is not ours. It's like another example. If I go and rent somebody's car, can I go sell the car? I went to the store, I rented a car, but I said, okay, I'm going to go sell it. Because no, you can't. Because you rented it, it's owned by somebody else. Right? Now, this ruh and this life is owned by Allah. We are just renting it. So we cannot end the life until Allah said, I want my life back. I want my amanah back. Then you say, ya Allah, it's yours, take it. So for me to end my life before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks for, is considered one of the grave sins. And that could lead a person to stay in the hellfire forever. Yes, we have the hadith as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that. That is number one. Number two, because life is one of the best Allah's gift to any being. Life is one of the precious gift of Allah. So abusing it in the wrong way causes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's anger, and yes, it causes the person to live, to stay in the hellfire forever. Yes.
Any more questions from sister side?
I think the second part of sister's question was that height of depression lead to suicide. And there is one ayah in Quran that God doesn't give anybody any taklif more than he can handle.
Yes. That's right. People think that when they become depressed, at certain point they feel like they cannot handle it anymore. So the best way to do it is to end their life, so that way all the problems ends. But I said, when you end your life, that is where all the problem begins. That's not ending. That's where it's taught now. Because now you have to answer Allah for taking your life, and then now you have a long journey in front of you. And number two, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you in a situation, right? Now, we have to remember, when we get ourselves into problems, we always jump to accuse Allah. No, sometimes it's our problem, our fault. And mashallah, you can see this in the marriages, right? When our marriage doesn't work, you say, we say, this is a kismet. Allah, He wanted this to happen. No, it's my problem. I didn't make the right choice to begin with. Right? When a problem started to come, Allah is always in the corner. Allah is your fault. You wanted it to be like, no, Allah is not the fault. Maybe I am the one who made the mistake to begin with. But then we forget ourselves in the picture, and then Allah is to be blamed in the middle. So now the point is, when something happened and I found I cannot handle, I have to go back and check. Because listen to the Quran, مَا أَصَابَ in Surah Al-Tawbah, مَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ. Allah says, whenever any tragedy comes upon you, it's because of your own actions. Not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, there are some tragedies. It's a test from Allah. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Mu'minun, that yes, alif lam in Surah Al-Rum, alif lam mim aghlibatur alif lam mim hasiban nasu an yutraku an yaqulu amanna wa hum la yuftanun. There is the test of Allah comes, right? But sometimes we are the people who cause ourselves to take some things that are more than what we can handle, and that has nothing to do with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And hopelessness is forbidden,
Allah. Absolutely.
Any question from the other side?
Yes. Tell no brother Shirazi, and then after.
Just a comment. Yes. There's a verse in the Quran that shaitan comes and scares you with poverty. So shaitan is well aware of a person who's going on the trial, and sometimes a person might think these are my thoughts, but that was possible for Nas.
That's right.
Doing haram,
absolutely. Yes, that's right.
There was just a comment. So, last question, Shiraji.
You were talking about depression. You said if you take an innocent life, or you do, you know, these things. And because I just was trying to relate that to an article I was reading last week.
Right.
In the United States, the rate of suicide in the army is at the highest level. Because there are a lot of soldiers. You know, they've come back from war and they're killing themselves. And there's a lot of talk about that and how to give counseling and all that.
Yeah.
You know, so is it the war they're, you know, fighting? I'm sure there is a correlation.
Right.
Why they are committing suicide. Is that right?
Right. And some of them, there are some of the reasoning that are behind it. Number one, some of them, one of the main issue is the medicine that they get, they were given when they come back. Those medication also, some of them, they have a high rate of, so what you call depression and suicide as well. That is one. And number two, some of them, when they come back, what they saw in that part of the world also cannot get out of their mind. And that also stayed with them, and they see that in their dream, they live with it. And that also caused them to get into that level as well. So yes, they have different reasoning that leads to that kind of, you know, suicide that they commit. Yes. Yes. Alaykum as-salam. Yes, mainly you can, when you look at the life, not just in America, in the West in general, there is this system of competition. Like everybody wants to be number one. And you can see even the world, the superpowers, they always have the problem of competition. That who is more powerful, who is more doing more than the other, who has more than the other. There is this kind of competition. Then when you come among the people also, there is this spirit that they have created that people always look at this like as the form of competition. And you can see, mashallah, this disease has come to our centers too. Mashallah, you come to the center, somebody write Mercedes, they say, oh, he's a doctor, I'm a doctor, and he's writing Mercedes, tomorrow I have to go get a Mercedes too. That is what the competition is, right? So that is the one of the diseases that we have when it's not supposed to be like that. Yes, in Islam, we're supposed to have a competition in terms of ibadah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Istibaq means competition in terms of the good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وَسَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Compete in terms of asking Allah's forgiveness. That is good. But in terms of he has this, I have to have it too. He doesn't have this, I shouldn't have it either. No, that is not part of the Islamic spirit. And that is one of the problems that we have in this country. Right? While when you come to Islam, Islam emphasizes about working together, working as a team, and cooperating with each other rather than working as competition between the two, rather than to work as we are competing with each other in terms of the materialism. So that is one of the biggest problems as well. Yes.
Depression nowadays is obviously more diagnosed. I mean, people are being diagnosed left and right in America. Way back, and it is probably because we have more access to the mental system here compared to back home.
All right.
But how was depression in the days of Prophet Muhammad? Was there a lot of depression during this time, during the time of
the answer is no. It wasn't as that many compared to our time. At the time of Imam Ali and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Yes, there were some people who came to the Prophet in some of the hadith and they complained to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, I'm having a depression. Or at the time of Imam Ali alayhi salam, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells them, for example, go and do dhikr. Remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, this certain time, this amount of time. Or somebody comes and says, Ya Rasulullah, I'm having depression. Then the Prophet said, then stop this sin, for example. Then you'll be able to overcome that. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Imam, they can see exactly the cause and then give you the medicine exactly what the problem is. But even with that, during those days, it wasn't as much as we have it today. Yes. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم صل على محمد.